Hello, I'm Don Preister with Green Bellevue. And today our Green Bellevue monthly program is here at the Bellevue Medical Center dealing with energy efficiency within your home. We have a couple of presenters who are professional energy raters. They go in and assess the air leakages throughout the home. They will be showing us information about how you can do it yourself or hire a professional, but the main thing is to get the house assessed. So Leon Komar, who is an energy home raider, can come out, bring a blower door to create a vacuum in the home, and then determine where the air leaks are throughout the system. Leon will be giving a main presentation, and he will go through a variety of things. We're happy to be able to present this information from our Green Bellevue ongoing nonprofit organization that's here to improve the quality of all of our lives in Bellevue. I will ask Tom Maruse, who is a Green Bellevue board member, to introduce the presenters today. And so, Tom, if you would come up, please. Thank you.
Repair authorizations for low-income families, emergencies, heating, plumbing, electrical, structural. So this kind of fell into this as a natural sideline or secondary career, like I said. Like I say, I've been at this for 8 years. Mark, it's what, three, four?
Six.
Six?
Time flies.
Wow. Yeah. Met Mark apparently 6 years ago after he took his Raiders training, and we both have a mutual friend, John Trout, maybe you know him. He's senior HERS Raider in Omaha, very supportive of green movements, air quality, etc. And both Mark and I are independent or sole proprietors of our businesses, but yet we consider each other as associates, where sometimes if one of us gets too busy and can't make a call, we might make a referral to the other, or at times we've actually subcontracted to each other on large projects. So Mark's one thing to fame in bio was that he's assisted with 2 years ago, Omaha re-energized program, and that was a government-sponsored weatherization or energy-saving program. And as HERS Raiders, we both do new home inspections. I've worked a lot in the private sector, done some work with nonprofits in Iowa, and Mark's currently working with Omaha Habitat for Humanity. So people who want to do a good job on making energy efficient homes, following certain guidelines, and getting them certified. So both proud to be associated with the Energy Star program. As far as this display goes, this is Mark's. I won't talk about it now until maybe take a little intermission now when we get to the IR cameras. Should I move over here, or how do we advance the...
you can just hit the space bar.
Hit the...
space bar on the keyboard.
Oh, okay. All right. Good. All right. How about that? Okay. Well, weatherization, what is that? That's kind of a vague term for a lot of people, but it's basically doing things to your home or place of business to make it weathertight and energy efficient. And we have a motto as energy raiders to seal tight, insulate, and ventilate right. And so that should give it to you in a nutshell, but we want to go on a little further because we consider ourselves also energy auditors. That's a term we used from way back. So maybe stepping into that, we should call these a little clearer, the energy upgrades for your home. So but the one main thing we want to add to our motto is to evaluate and prioritize. And that's what we're here to help you with today. We passed out some government handouts which should help guide you through this. I'm going to give you an overview today. Try to look at your homes the way we look at them. And maybe boring to some, too technical for others, and hopefully make some kind of sense that you can move on and hopefully do what you do some of these things yourself. You know, like I said, self-guided. You can have a self-guided evaluation. We've got free handouts here, and also some do-it-yourself books. These are just about the Bible for SERS raters of insulating weather eyes. This is their first version. This is the revised and updated, more colorful. You just pass them down the line, and we have a couple. We have a few of these for sale if you want them. And if not, you can find them online at Amazon. Other ways to go about learning more about weatherization, energy savings, go to utility company or the EPA or Energy Star websites. On that screen, I've got OPPD. Can't see it from here, but there's a photo of one of our associates there, Gary Rulison. He's been an energy advisor for many years and also a HERS reader, as we are. So they do not do energy audits, well, but they do promote the practice. So, okay, so who's if you don't do the self-guided tour, who's qualified? Well, energy auditor, like I say, that's the old term, energy evaluator. There's a lot of people out there who have some training in that area. Like I said, we're HERS, our home energy rating raters, HERS raters, and we are ResNet certified. That's the national organization, and well, keeps us honest. We're held to high professional standards, can't have any conflicts of interest, and if we do have, say, a product to sell, have to disclaim, provide disclaimers, you know, provide our service so there's no conflict of interest. There's another organization out there, the Building Performance, or BPI, Building Performance Institute. They have a similar program. They also go beyond that in certifying contractors to do these kind of works. Again, contact the utility company, but they don't make house calls anymore. So, well, how about a salesman? You know, there's plenty of window salesmen, insulation companies offering you a free energy audit. Well, what do you suppose? They're going to sell the other person's product? No, not usually. They have a vested interest, and you have to weigh what they say. And hopefully, we might present some things here today that make you rethink bias a salesman might have. There are some, I'll grant you this, there are some good folks out there. In the past, I've gotten a few referrals for energy audits from insulators who, when confronted with helping a homeowner with ice dams in the winter, they want to make sure they did it right, so they referred the homeowner to contact one of us. So, there's some honest folks out there. Okay, what do we do in our energy evaluation? Well, there's a blower door or air leakage test. It pulls the air through the house, and we measure how much airflow there is, and it can also point out where your air leakage points are. Thermal imaging, we use an infrared scan. That's this little jobber creates these pictures. Get to that in a minute. Thorough visual inspection. You just don't want to flash a camera around or take a quick glance at things. It's good to crawl into the attic, get dirty, and make sure you know what you're talking about and giving a thorough evaluation of the house. Combustion safety, or carbon monoxide testing, very important, but most of us have gas furnaces or a gas stove and gas water heaters. Heck, even if you have all, you're all electric, you got an attached garage, you can get CO fumes in your garage in the house. Those are the things we take very seriously, and we also have advanced detection devices for that. Gas leakage, natural gas, propane, again, serious business. And, at least as part of our resident certification, we're required to have both the CO and gas leakage tests, so hopefully we'll be on the call in any of the audits we do. But of course, as you know, the local gas company, MED, if you ever have any trouble, if you suspect the slightest questions you have a gas leak, call them. By federal law, they have to respond within an hour. HVAC evaluation, that service varies from rater to rater. We've had general training and equipment performance, and our skills vary from there too. And always constantly learning, and so hopefully there too when it comes to recommending equipment changes or upgrades, we'll give you an honest evaluation on that too. Okay, these are two basic tools of the trade. When I started 8 years ago, the blower door was our main air leakage test device. It's a big portable unit. The red shroud goes into a frame, fits into any entry door, has about a 24-inch diameter fan. Pulls the air out of the building, and we can sense where the air leakage are. Back in the old days, all we had to do is put our hand up against an air leakage point, feel the air come in and say, I've got an air leak over here. Or use a smoke pen and you can visually see it. But today's technology, infrared cameras, they're a tool of the trade in a lot of businesses now, and the prices have come down. This is one of the ones that we use, Mark has here, and I think we'll let you know a little about IR scans. looking through a new set of eyes. And if you see that, well, that's one of our cats.
Oh.
A little parlor trick that we like to do on energy audits, take the IR camera and take a picture of someone's pet dog or cat, and you can see, you know, something you're familiar with. A cat has fur, that's their insulation. And the fur is dark, it's not letting all the heat out. So cooler or insulated areas would, in this picture, would be deep purple or blue. The face is not, no fur there, there's a lot more skin exposed. You're getting into yellows and greens, more heat being let off. And look at those eyes. Yeah, red. That's the least coverage you have here. So that's the hottest part out there. There's, and that's pretty much how we diagnose problem areas in the house. And in the background, I wish I would have back in the claimed that was one of the photos I'd taken, but that's a well-insulated house in winter. Hmm. The blue shows that very little of the heat is coming out of the house. See the windows and door outlines? Well, I got a little more heat coming out of there. But also, look at that white yellow band across the bottom. That's an uninsulated concrete slab. That's one of the last vestiges or last opportunities we have to improve insulation quality, whole package on your house. So, talk about these here a little.
Well, these are some infrared photos that I took, mostly on different audits. Yeah, just to describe what I found, this house was where somebody called me because he had had his walls insulated and didn't feel that he was getting the results that he expected. This was done, his walls were injected with foam, which can be a very good way to retrofit walls that need insulation. But you can see that there's a lot of color variation and therefore temperature variation across the wall. You know, let's see, this was done in cold weather. With the camera that I use, there is a temperature scale on the right side of the image. So in this particular case, the lowest temperature that was visible was 53 degrees. And by the way, the camera doesn't see air temperatures. It has to look at a solid surface and get the temperature of that. So 53 degrees is the coldest surface it can see, and 70 degrees was the warmest. I was able to basically give him some backup on his claim that the insulation wasn't done correctly. Similarly on this house, and this house was in Bellevue, by the way. This was a house that had I believe it was cellulose insulation blown in some years previous to the audit. And I don't know exactly why, but the homeowner was concerned that maybe he wasn't getting the results that he needed. And as you can see, the walls are warm up to about here, and it varies. You can see the stud position there and there. So the different wall cavities have different amounts of insulation in them, and it's all settled down, not all the way up to the ceiling. We're doing quality control with the infrared camera in these photos. This photo here is very common. I mean, almost every house that I go into, I can count on getting this picture. This is the attic hatch. An attic hatch is an exterior door that's up on your ceiling and very rarely has any weather strip. And you wouldn't have a door without weather strip on your house, like an entry door. So what we're seeing here is cold air being pulled in by the blower door. We use them together, typically. Pulled in from the attic, and it's blowing in where you would have weather strip, but also around the outside of the trim, because the trim is just sort of nailed up there, and then the lid is set on the trim, and there's air leakage between the drywall ceiling and the trim. And that's a serious leak there. This is just a photo, just kind of an interesting thing, not part of an audit, but similar to the example Leon just gave, where you see the heat on the windows. Let's see what else. An uninsulated basement wall here, where the warmth you can see coming out.
That last one looks pretty well insulated, is it?
It is pretty good, yeah.
Okay.
Except for that that basement wall is an Achilles heel on the house.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to be using a few more examples here. Presentation. It's kind of a way to break the ice here. But we can go on. We plan on having a question and answer session after the presentation. Anything? But any questions right now about the IR cameras?
Can we just borrow one for fun to go home and see what my house looks like? How much did that cost you, Mark?
I think that was about $3,000.
They have an iPhone version out for $300, so.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm tempted to buy that.
I just said borrow it.
I know. Okay.
Yeah, and on that iPhone version, I had a client who was in HVAC, and that's a really good thing for them to have. I mean, everybody who is professional doing something with heating and cooling should have at least a basic infrared camera, and more they're getting into the market.
Yeah, it's like I say, it's a tool of the trade for a lot of businesses. The heating and cooling guys can point it at an outside air conditioner condenser, and you can see hot spots in it. And that can indicate, well, the wiring's bad here, or it's got a bad coolant flow there. And electricians, too, pointed at a electrical panel, and they can see a circuit overloading. They know exactly which one is going to give them trouble, other than blowing fuse or drip circuit breaker. So, pretty handy things. And also, they use them in medicine, of course. I've seen some examples. Veterinarians take them from animals. You know, if you have a bad spot heating up on your body, that's something that indicates a problem there. Okay. But here's what we used to do, and before they had the IR scan, just kind of look at the winter snow melt. And if you don't want to go buy an IR camera, just take a look at your house in winter. This can give you some idea of where some weak points are. This house is well over 100 years old on the north side of Omaha, and no insulation in the sidewalls. Heat goes up and melts the snow. Snow comes down and overloads the gutter. The gutter starts sagging with ice. So one of my pastimes, if you will, or you drive through town, is kind of look at roofs and, that's interesting. Drives my wife crazy. And yet, it doesn't have to be a 100-year-old house. I forget how old this house is. It's went on an audit there. It's maybe built in late 1900s. I mean, not late, yeah, late 1900s. See a big spot of melted snow above the skylight. Guess what? Skylight wall has no insulation in it. Never did. All four sides. Was that homespun? Did the building original builder put it in that way? Never know. But it's a heck of a nice feature of the house being put in incorrectly. And we see that all the time. There's a lot of stories we can tell. But yet alone, here's another. That's one of my favorite cartoons. And if you can't read it, this is an energy audit in hell. There's an energy auditor looking at a heat coming out of a volcano. That's where you're losing a lot of your heat, right there. So, wish things could be that obvious. So that's where we're here today to kind of shed a little light on other things that are hidden. Okay. For a do-it-yourself weatherization, we encourage you to evaluate your energy saving needs. Read the booklets. Figure out what you want to do. Develop a scope of work. Can't do everything, and we don't have budgets to work with. The main thing is to prioritize, get a logical pattern going. Sometimes people, in our estimation, jump the gun. It's not unusual for us to get a call from someone who's gung-ho about upgrading their house. They just had new windows put in, had it re-insulated, had the new attic insulation put in. You come out there, and sometimes a little too late to give an evaluation and take action on some critical things. Focus in on some attic repair needs, and attic is one of the trickier places to get things going. You may or may not want to do it as a do-it-yourself project. But once that foot or more of insulation is put in there, it's awfully hard to go tracing through and check the ductwork, check other problems, areas. We'll see them with our infrared camera from below, but the only way you can fix it is by moving the insulation around. Awfully messy. Know your limitations. Like I said, I encourage the do-it-yourself aspect. That's pretty much how Dad was around the house, and this apple doesn't fall far from that tree. I like to do a lot of, you know, part of my experience as a carpenter, and so I have a good skill set going into this, and once more, the knowledge. And so if you're lacking on any part of that, of course, don't ever attempt going up in your attic or climb up a ladder if you've got a fear of heights. So know your limitations. But like I say, do your own weatherization work. In fact, we're going to hit on a lot of things here that we're going to say, I can do that. So as long as you're doing something, you can move forward. But of course, hire licensed personnel. Pretty much Omaha, Bellevue emphasized hiring licensed HVAC contractors. Most of them are legit. Some of them, if you get a feeling like they're a snake oil salesman, well, maybe you get a second opinion. But there's a lot of good, honest professionals out there. And even now, I can sense it when I'm talking to somebody I can trust. And so hopefully we all can do that. But of course, once again, safety first in attempting anything by yourself. Now, we have a display in the back, and in one of the handouts, brochures that we gave, this is a classic air sealing diagram. It shows air leaking in from in and out of the house from all directions. And like I say, some houses are like sealed. One idea is to tighten it up. And for me, weatherization, well, you think of weather. That's the outdoors, right? Rain, snow, wind. Well, that's a limited approach to weatherization if you look at the house as a whole. You caulk windows and siding, focus in on your mortar joints and caulk or tuck point them. That's good. And I'm really at a loss to kind of expand on that any much more going on the envelope, talking about roofing. And that plays an effect on how your house functions with energy. But we're going to go from there to the inside. This is a picture of the outside. Well, what do we see over there? That's a severe window rot. These were new windows, relatively new windows, trim and all. Full replacement. When you pull off the trim, what do you find? All they did was stuff insulation, fiberglass insulation. That was supposed to be stop your air leakage or what have you. We have a motto creators. Insulation without an air barrier. See how insulation without an air barrier acts as an air filter. If you think about it, if you've seen fiberglass insulation, very porous. Air can go through it. In fact, the R value of any insulation means it provides resistance. It doesn't stop heat transfer. It slows it down. And with heat transfer, air, water, they all follow the same paths. So all you did was stuff porous material in that crack. Water can move either way. In this case, we suspected that there may have been a pressure difference from inside the house to the outside that drove bathroom moisture through that crack and just rotted it out. It was rotted out from behind. It was well caulked all the way around. It was a painter's house. Very good at that. Anyhow, in tearing it apart to do the replacement of the trim, foamed it up from the outside. Now, that's a lot of work. I don't expect you to do that on your houses. Most of us live in old houses, maybe older than 10 years old, 20 years old. They weren't foaming. Nowadays, it's required by code to foam these gaps, so we have a better chance of being done right. But what we can do, and this was shown on all of our energy audits, whether it's a blower door air leakage test or infrared camera scan. This is an infrared picture in winter. The warm walls show air leakage coming down in that corner of this window. You got this crack in the miter joint. You also see some air coming down. Well, earlier Mark was talking about the attic axis. Same thing holds true there. Any joint on there, vertical, horizontal, diagonal, any transition between the plastic window housing to the trim, potential for leakage. And if it's not 100% sealed in the wall cavity, it's going to leak. Now here's I don't know if it's the same house, but the same situation there. You see a green, purplish spot in the middle of the trim. That's, you can hardly see it on this projector, but there's a gap, a running gap right there. So the air leaks from the outside through the insulation, if it's there at all, and then down. So, what we recommend, like I say, the average homeowner can do this. How do we back up here? Is that possible? Maybe try this.
Oh,
caulk. And we recommend a clear, paintable caulk. What's caulk? There's the caulk gun right there.
You know, well, I know. What's it made of? What is caulk?
You're going beyond my skill set. Okay. There's various types
like
of it.
Like a clay?
No,
it's fluid, like toothpaste. It's
a pasty.
Don't use toothpaste.
Some of them are latex based. Some of them are silicone based.
Oh, okay.
Whether it's indoor, outdoor, paintable.
Yeah, and indoor, outdoor, and there are some that are not paintable. You get 100% silicone, and whatever color it is, that's what it is for life, even clear. And if you were to caulk that joint with a clear 100% silicone, it might look good for right now. But come a couple of years from now, if you want to repaint that, or you splattered some on the wall, you can't cover it. 100% silicone. It's not paintable. There are numerous types out there, if you got one room where you've got painted trim, another room where you've got wood stain, it goes up a long way. So covers all those joints, and I might add there too. My daughter bought she and her husband bought their house about 10 years ago. Of course, they asked Dad to help out with some of the move-in repairs, and then did an energy audit and got her fired up, and she went around caulking the house and considered herself a caulking queen. So if any of you ladies there want to challenge her for that title, I'm sure she wouldn't mind. Okay. Air leaks are pervasive, and like I said, when you think of weatherization, most of us probably think of door weather stripping or thresholds. That's important. And you can see here a door where this is, again, a winter picture. Air is coming in through different leaks here. But concerning this room, this door, this is to the attached garage. And like I said, just like your attic door should treat like a door to the outside, so should your garage door. And it's not just keeping the cold out, it's keeping those gasoline fumes, exhaust fumes from coming in. And could, I want to keep this short, I'm not going to go into all the different options of weather stripping. If you're inclined to check your house out and do it, I'm sure the guys at the hardware store will set you up with the right stuff. So. And, you know, one inspection tool I have is, if I can see daylight through a building material, chances are it's not properly sealed. So, this, believe it or not, was a new building. Concrete floor, slab on grade. I don't know if they hung the door wrong or the concrete finish was wrong. Well, and that black line across there, that's a built-in weather strip that pre-hung door had. Doesn't do a lot of good. So, I don't know how they ever resolved that, but a quick fix for most of us is to put a threshold under the door or a sweep. So, it's a little tougher when it's a steel door. And as we'll see a little later on, air leaks are pervasive. They come through the walls, entering through the attic, inside the walls, and they come out to any opening in your living area. So one thing you should do is caulk or seal any plumbing penetration. These are all commonly seen in all of our houses. And believe it or not, even your electrical outlets. See that little orange spot in the middle of the wall there? That's an electrical outlet. Now, this is a summer photo, so the walls are cool and hot air is coming through it. Well, the middle photo shows you got a gap in between the box and your drywall. And if you looked a little further, you'd see that there's holes where the wires come in or unsealed. Air is leaking through it. So one way to fix that, of course, is to caulk around it, if you will, but you still got these air leaks from back. And in the hardware store, they sell these foam covers. They go in between the wall and your cover plate. Pretty effective. And I guess if you really want to be serious, you can use those little baby protectors, infant guards, put them in the holes in the outlet.
Okay, I see those given out a lot for the switches. Not as much for the round poles, but for actually light switches. So they're worth picking up if you see them, and they say take a couple each, you take 50 or 12, whatever.
Count your outlets and switches.
Okay.
And you know, these are the standard, I consider the old time design, duplex outlet. And there's also, well, there's other shapes out now. You have the Leviton, squarish outlets, so you have to get creative in finding them or adapting them. And then it gets a little complicated if you have like a three-gang box, you know, two or three-gang, but more power to you.
It generally is a good cost-effective improvement to make.
Okay, so they're worth either the cost or getting them. It is something that you probably should be putting on your house then.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
They're not expensive, and they make all of those various styles and designs. I found all of them, and I put them all in, and they're pretty simple to do.
Mm-hmm. How much would a little, I mean, just that simple little upgrade, how much would that be helping with your energy bills and the loss? Are we talking 0.5%, 20?
It's small in the scope of things. Like I say, the thing is, you have to prioritize, you know, go for the big fish, big bang for the buck. I really couldn't put a dollar amount on it anymore.
Well, I tell people this, and I know it doesn't make them happy, but it really depends on the house, the situation. If you have ducts in your attic, for instance, And the joints on those ducts are not sealed. That's probably the most important thing to do. But again, it depends. I was in a house in Dundee that had been remodeled on the top level, and they still had connections between the indoor space and the roof fence. So that would be a high priority there. So it really depends on the house and the situation.
Okay, but yeah. Every little thing helps, basically.
Yeah, and this is a low cost, easy homeowner thing. So it's easy for us to say, yeah, go ahead and do that. That's a good bang for your buck there.
Yeah, and you know, it depends on your comfort level too. Whatever trips your trigger, and you might be your TV chair might be right by a switch, and you can actually feel this sometimes. You know, if the conditions are right, and okay, well, that's one place to start. And I do recall within the last year I did a HERS rating final. That's not quite to the same standard as the Energy Star homes that we do. And during our test, or blower door test on that, we had a strong leak on several outlets, and I know the homeowner was really perturbed about that. What can be done? You know? Here's how I would see it. And I don't know if they did anything. But, you know, with Don chiming in, I know he's been involved in energy saving activities for a long time, so if you can't reach me, call him. I'm sure he knows that.
So, got a question. Are you saying that it's not just the exterior plugs, but all the plugs in your house?
Right.
It isn't, because it's, I always thought it was just the outside ones.
No. Oh. When you have an air leak in the attic, it's coming down all your walls. Exterior, well, some of your exterior air leaks come through the exterior wall, but and it's I know I was surprised the first time I experienced it.
Very often they are worse on an exterior wall.
Oh yeah.
If the wind is blowing against that wall, mm-hmm. when we do a blower door test, we're pulling air in from every direction at once. And so that is going to drive leaks through those interior walls because it's coming down from the attic if the attic is not sealed. Now that's going to indicate to us maybe not your typical sort of leak, but when we go away and it's warm in the house, very often you'll have that warm air going up through that leak, up into the attic instead of the reverse. So
are you going to explain about what kind of, how you can have a leak in your attic or not?
Yeah, we'll go into that. And one thing that's kind of glossed over is that air leakage in buildings is two ways. It can come in from the outside or come from the outside. Comes from the outside in or inside out. Depends on the pressure zones. You know, barometric pressure changes. You have high pressure cold front come in, Arctic front. High pressure is going to drive things inside. During the summer, you got low pressure, and so the inside air might go outside. And depending on how your house is set up, you can create individual pressure zones depending on how your HVAC equipment is regulated. It's complex, and there's ways to kind of even things out, but still. Nature or physics working with or against you, and so it can get
complicated, and very often people don't understand or don't even believe some things that we might tell them, but then they see it during an audit and are surprised. And I mean, I know I was surprised when I had my first audit done on my house.
And the same thing for me. Like I said, it's my second career. I was 29 years with the city of Omaha, basically working in all the trades. But yet when I took my Raiders training, it was mind-opening. It's just these things that I hadn't heard before. And then it's experiential, too. And both Mark and I are somewhat technically or construction oriented, so maybe we can grasp these things, and hopefully part of our job is also to communicate these things with you. And if you ever have any questions here throughout presentation, feel free to ask. Those are some good questions, because it's kind of a hard concept to wrap your mind around. Any more? Okay. All right, and another thing. One thing that surprises a lot of people when we do our test is we have these glowing discolorations at the base of the wall. If you look at that picture there, stick a pencil in this gap between the floor and the baseboard. I don't care if the house was built 100 years ago or last week, the nature of the building products is that it's almost always a gap in between your wall and your floor. Nowadays they have what's called sill sealer that helps buffer that, but still it's another point of entry into the house. And when we do our tests, we see these colorful streaks. One way of curing that is, again, caulking the perimeter of a floor. This happens to be a wood floor. Well, pull up the base you were quartered around, caulk it, put it back down, problem solved. It's a little more difficult when you have wall-to-wall carpeting. I've never tried it myself. I imagine it could be done pulling down the carpet and caulking it. Bound to make a mess. I wouldn't recommend it, but
I can speak to that. I don't mind carpet. Usually there's about a half inch gap underneath the baseboard that the carpet is tucked into, and it's usually pretty easy to grab it in a corner and peel that carpet back, and then take some expanding foam in a can and squirt it underneath the really underneath the drywall, between the drywall and the subfloor, there's usually a gap of about a half an inch. And that's where the leak comes in. Once you fill that with expanding foam, before that foam hardens, you can tuck the carpet back in. And I like that improvement.
Yeah, I imagine you can hold it back with, and I thought about it too, to hold it back with like a painter's straight edge or something.
Well, you can put one knee on the carpet while the other knee is on the carpet pad, and you spill some on the underside of the carpet, it's no big deal.
Yeah. Well, if some of the pictures or scenes in these photos look familiar, they're mostly from my own personal remodels or upgrades. So this is, our house is about 1920, a lot of oak floor on the first floor. And just before we had the floors refinished, I took the trim off and the base sheet and caulked it, and it made it a little easier for me.
Is that clear caulk or is that?
No, it may or may not be, but the fact that you put a quarter round over it, nobody sees it. Mm-hmm. And this also brings up a good point about it, how experiential these things are. Several years ago, a local builder, a name drop if you want, and he favors building new homes in Sarpy County. We recruited him for the Energy Star program, and as we're going through all the different requirements and techniques used in air sealing, we mentioned about sealing the gap along the floor, and he says, slapped him in the head, he says, you know, 30 years ago when I was a framing carpenter, I remember sitting down on the floor on a windy day and feeling air coming through that crack along the floor. That made me a firm believer in caulking that gap right then and there. And I'll tell you what, he built some of the best houses I see. So it's not rocket science, but it is kind of an interesting thing. Okay. Other things. One of my personal pet peeves are your ceiling, your bathroom fans. I don't know if it's clear, but that's a picture of a winter air leakage. You've got cold attic air coming in and spreading out along the warm ceiling. And it's almost 20 degrees cooler than the room temperature. But there's a large, sometimes a very large gap around the bathroom fan housing. You take off the grill or foam seal that. Kitchen exhaust And by the way, if you have a kitchen fan, it's best to have that exhausted to the outside. It takes excess moisture and odors out the door. But if you have a vented kitchen hood, well, just a little caulk around the metal as it goes through the cabinet and at the ceiling. The one on the left is one of the worst I've ever seen. I can't believe it. It's just, you see these things and it's like, it didn't matter. You know, it's out of sight, out of mind. It takes a little more caulk to fix that. If you have a room where, well, this particular one on the left is a second floor furnace room with pipes going up into the attic. The drywall's unfinished and the holes around the pipes are not sealed. Well, the right conditions, you got attic air coming down. And so, same thing here, this is the same room. And I'd like to say it's a handyman project that was forgotten, but this is on new construction that I saw just last week. So,
is there a code for that? I mean,
there is a code, and I just hope that the building inspector caught that after I was on site.
About that.
So, yeah,
we
call these things air barriers. You know, in the building code, they call them fire stops. Basically, any pathway that air can move, fire can move too. It should be fire stop. By code, there should probably be a metal plate on the other side of it, cut up exactly tight. Over on those black air conditioning lines, you see the attic insulation. So, I caution the heating contractor. You know, you might get complaints because of this. You might tell the builder about this, and the building code inspector might gig you on it. I don't know what happened. Try to relay as much of this as possible. And these things are critical. Like I say, your ceiling separates your living area from the attic. And this, just like with your doors, this is my version of Mark's photo, your attic hatch separates living area from the attic. All sorts of air leaks there. Weather strip, and make sure it's got insulation on the top of the lid. Secured. That's a problem you see in a lot of houses, that somebody may have thrown a big bat of insulation over the access door first time it's used and pushed aside to service something up there. That insulation falls off, it's there in the attic, and you just have a chunk of wood separating.
Can I interject something? Energy Star has requirements, a lot of different rules that you have to check the box. And one of the requirements is attic hatches have to have insulation, durable insulation, permanently attached to the attic hatch lid. Apparently it's not required by building code, but it's a really good idea, and that's why it's an Energy Star, so that's what I recommend.
Yeah, and oftentimes we'll go out to a final, whether it's Energy Star or not, and it's not fastened, and it's like it's not a requirement for the insulator to do. Like I said, they may throw a piece into the attic, but it's not fastened to the lid.
Are the attic hatches usually, and how are they usually in the garage or in the house?
It depends.
So is it better? I mean, is it less?
It's better
if it's in the garage.
It's better in the garage.
Because the garage isn't going to be, because that's where mine is.
Right.
Yeah, that's good if you have a ranch style house. That's your access there. And I would encourage that too. However, a lot of the houses, they're in, say, a closet ceiling or maybe in the hallway.
Closet ceiling by the front door.
Yeah, that's mine.
That's unusual.
It's typical for an older house to have an attic hatch in the house.
35 years? built in 78?
It depends on the design of the house. I've got a story and a half, which means, you know, second floor is got beveled ceilings and side walls. I have access doors on the side. They're hinged access doors. I make sure that they have plenty of insulation on them.
If it's in the garage, you don't need to insulate it. You don't need to weatherproof it. It's not an issue.
And as far as garage insulation, that's usually we focus in on the house. If you wanted to semi-condition your garage, it might be a good idea to have attic insulation in over the garage. We're not talking about garages too much, other than, oh, that's the next slide. Okay. Another big sore point for me is if you have ceiling registers, they too should be the metal boot, the housing in the wall or the ceiling should be sealed to the drywall. That's a picture of a winter situation. Cold attic air is seeping in alongside of the boot and coming into the house. And along with attic air, you've got any kind of dust, contaminants, mold, who knows what. And just last year, I saw about the worst ever. Just about an inch and a half gap in place. I can't recall it.
What part of the attic is that?
Oh, this is, we have some houses, like a second floor house, might have heat registers in the ceiling. You got large rectangular ones here. But behind it are the ducts feeding the register, and it's got a metal housing. And that metal housing we call the boot. Well, that's installed in first, and then the drywallers come and put drywall over it, and they cut it out roughly. Seems like sealing the connection point is in nobody's job description. And it's just about, well, other than if we have an Energy Star home, we have to make sure that it's sealed. We know the value of that. It gets lost in the shuffle. Doesn't seem to be the heating contractor's responsibility. Painters don't do it. So
it doesn't get done. And the current energy code in our area does not require sealing that gap, and that's an important gap. There's a lot of energy being lost that way, and houses are being built right and left with this kind of thing. Leon and I test those on a weekly basis. Because the code requires testing of duct leakage on houses that have ducts in the attic or in some other unconditioned space. Well, this is kind of something that the code missed, in my opinion, is sealing that gap.
Or it just may be an interpretation or an oversight.
Yeah, well, I think it was arrived at by negotiation with the industry groups. The next code to be adopted is going to require sealing all penetrations of the envelope, which this would be one of those. So when we get the next code, this problem will be solved as long as everybody does his job on enforcing the code.
In my opinion of code, it's when and if we get the new code. That's,
The code we're on now is 2009 International Energy Efficiency Code. The next one could be the 2012 or the 2015.
And
so we're a little bit behind.
Yeah. It's possibly political.
So these are international codes that have to be adopted locally.
Right. Yeah. What was it, like 3-4 years ago? The state of Nebraska adopted the 2009 Energy Code.
Okay, even though they're working on 2015, we haven't.
Well, 2015's been decided, and it's out. It's in publication, and some locales are adopting it.
So this has to, the council has to adopt it each year, where they're going to change it.
Either your local city council, or in our case, state most often takes the lead. And that's what at least one benefit of the 2009 code, that they do require duct leakage testing. And I guess it's a
way for us. Really, really good builder, go 2015 code.
A really good builder would do his own thing that would be above code requirements.
Yeah. And there's ways of checking that, but by and large, most builders are businessmen first, and they're watching the pennies. Yeah. And just finding the slightest margin.
Not watching ours.
Of course not.
No, that's right.
In the long run.
Well, right. Hearthstone?
Hearthstone does?
Well, they're out of business right now. They were Energy Star builders for a while, so that was a commitment to building beyond code. That was, they went out of business before the 2009 was adopted. But I guess one side effect of the increased code change is that, you know, as a sideline, Mark and I do duct leakage tests. We're for hire for local HVAC contractors. And like I say, it's knowing what our standards are for Energy Star homes and seeing things built less than that, it's kind of disappointing. There needs to be an upgrade in the general building community, and that's through code.
So you see things that are built to code now, but you deal with the Energy Star, and they're not up to it yet, but they're still compliant.
Energy Star seems to be the national testing ground. They were testing duct work, I don't know, when they first in, was it 2000, about year 2000 when they came in. It's been around for a while, and we do that as part of our Energy Star certification. But
part of Energy Star's philosophy is to always be more stringent than code, a little bit more stringent than code, so that the builders in an area can claim to be better than code. You know, some of them that want to do that, market it that way. And as Leon suggested, it's a kind of a proving ground for some of the things that might be incorporated in code in the future.
In this example on there, are you going to show us how you would seal?
Pocket. Oh, with that, you know, if we wanted to talk about duct sealing, we'd have to add another 15-30 minutes on this. There's a lot to be said for that, and I'd like to go into that, but not today.
If your house is built today and it's got ducts in the attic, someone like Leon or I would do a duct test on it and ensure that the ducts themselves are tight to a certain standard, but this gap wouldn't necessarily be sealed. And that's something that's very easy for a homeowner to do. It's very, very good. It's like the best bang for your buck.
Just take your caulking gun and go around here. That's it. Let it dry and then put your register back on.
And the buyer one, you'd have to take
foam. Yeah, foam. Yeah, and that's how they fixed it. Or said they were going to fix it.
Isn't the foam done here, expanding foam? How do you know how much to put in it? Can't you put too much where it...
Out of something like that. The concern would be if you're foaming
a door. It was my
a door or window, and then you don't want a high expansion foam, something that's going to burst or expand the door trim from the wall.
So you don't want to use that kind
of foam. High expansion. There is low expansion, so you could use either on that sort of situation. Mm. And myself, I have a professional model gun. And that you can reuse and reuse. But if you buy one of those cans, I should have brought one for show and tell. And great stuff. You just pretty much have to use it all in one show. The sealant gets into the tube, solidifies, and you've lost the can for another day.
My brother showed me a trick. I'm cleaning it, but I forgot how we did it.
Well, it's the same trick.
He might have just washed it out.
It was no.
Well, it was.
It was. It's the same trick that I used until I bought myself a pro gun. It's like a spray can, a paint spray can, with a long plastic tube where it gets solidified is in the plastic trigger and the tube. Xylene is the recommended solvent. You just get xylene and a pipe cleaner, run it through the tube, and soak your nozzle in that tube. In fact, they do sell a gun cleaner. I mean, a foam gun cleaner, which has got basically a xylene base. That stuff strips paint too. Yeah. So that's what they use to clean up their mess, their spills, and take paint right off the steel siding. So good stuff, I guess. Well, I think this is what I was waiting for. All right, emphasizing your ceiling in your house, the ceiling to the attic. Well, you also have, if you have what we call a tuck-under garage, you have to be concerned about that ceiling as well. Oftentimes, this house, all these photos are from the same house, is like worst case. Plumbing pipes were repaired. They didn't patch the ceiling plaster. There is a close chute going from the bathroom into the garage. And since this house was built in the 60s, they thought it'd be a good idea to put a supply register in the garage. All these are potentials for air leakage, fumes, everything coming into the house. You don't want that. I didn't have time to show to include all the completed and finished photos. There are six. There are also in the garage ceiling. There's only like 3 inches of insulation in a 8-inch joist. Like I say, we could go into another topic on insulation. That garage ceiling should. Nowadays, they found out that garage ceiling joists should be filled with insulation. And so, project here. I worked with a nonprofit on this. We patched up the ceilings, took out the close chute, patched it up upstairs too, sealed off the register, had a professional insulator come in, insulated all the ceiling joists, and that woman said that was the most comfortable summer she's ever had in the house. So, I don't know how many of you are familiar with builders or builder slang, but you know the room over a garage, they often call a cold floor. Why? Because you're always cold.
Yeah.
So there is, hopefully they're not building them like that anymore, but it's, if it's built correctly, it should be comfortable as the rest of the house. So, like I say, there's a whole other side story to go on this house here. So, that basically takes care of the inside of the house, the things that we normally see. Doing the attic takes a little more attention, and like I say, not for the faint of heart. And we really need to want to encourage, if you're going to do it by yourself or hire somebody, make sure all these the following things are done before you go further with the insulation. Perform all preliminary work first, which includes air sealing, checking any sidewalls that are in the attic. If you have a two-story, you have a sidewall that you often return. We call it knee walls. Check any ductwork in the attic. Repair it. Correct any ventilation issues. Your attic has to breathe. Air comes in through the eave vents and out the peak. Check wiring. You don't want to cover up hazardous wiring before you install it with insulation. And safety first.
We've done that.
Oops. You've done that?
My daughter did. Yeah.
Oh.
Came right to the living room.
That, believe it or not, is one of my favorite photos. I didn't do it. I crawled around a lot of attics and I've never put my foot through the ceiling yet.
Yeah.
that was done. One builder I worked with built a new home. We did our final inspection and tests. Went up in the attic, checking the air leaks and insulation. And on the way back to out of the attic, he put his foot through the ceiling of his new home. And I like it. It almost looks like a footprint, right?
Yeah, it does. It's like Sasquatch. Living in the basement.
And this is a guy with years of experience walking in, around in an attic, so it can happen to anybody. But if you're not comfortable doing it, crawling around in dusty attics, and don't do it. But if you do, wear protective clothing, face mask, and that's critical. You know, I don't know if he's blowing cellulose or fiberglass insulation, but any of that stuff gets in your lungs, it can irritate you. Times I've taken a quick trip in an attic without one and come down, sometimes I'm coughing. I've got some itching on my arms. The fact is, he should have a long sleeve shirt there. The idea is he's got a face mask on and gloves.
When I got new lights in my kitchen, they went up in the attic, you know, the flat lights, and then this one or two lights kept blinking. They wouldn't go on. And it was in the winter, and he said it was because they hadn't put the insulation back over the light or something. It has something to do with it was cold, or I don't know.
Well,
is that wrong?
If it's blinking, it might mean that there's a loose wire.
Well, they did replace one of them, but then I think
there's other possibilities. Depending on.
I thought it had something to do with the
insulation. I don't have anything about the recessed lights or
the can lights.
Nowadays, the newer ones are sealed and should be airtight, and you should not have air leakage. But and most of them, I think, are most can lights are thermally protected. If they're covered with insulation and enough heat builds up in it, It'll turn it off.
New ones.
New ones. Yeah.
So you shouldn't have insulation over them?
Old ones,
maybe
you
not.
You have to be careful.
Yeah.
These are new.
They're new, they're probably okay, but I would check for IC on a label inside the can. Look for IC, insulation contact. Mm-hmm. If it's rated for insulation contact, let's say IC or...
We should cut the insulation around. We shouldn't.
No, if it's rated for insulation contact, then you can put insulation right up against it.
Oh, okay.
From the attic side.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't go into all the details here, but there are certain procedures or practices you can do to protect a can light from insulation and causing it. But another good thing to do or consider, if it is thermally protected and it keeps going off, that means you have too high of a bulb in there. And incandescent, the old standard light bulbs, they produce a lot of heat. And the thing is, the thermal protection protects the device and the wires from overheating and causing a fire. Well, CFLs or LED lights are low heat production. You could change that out and see if that helps.
I do have LEDs. They are LEDs.
They are.
Yeah.
If you still have a problem with this,
it just happened when you first put him in. Yeah.
Okay.
No.
You were coming over tonight.
He was in a light, certified.
Okay. So. Should I start speeding up here? Okay.
Format warning.
Well. Okay. This is what we're talking about, attic air leaks. This picture on the left shows streaks of purple and yellow coming down from the attic. You can see the outline of each joist. This picture on the top shows maybe an eighth or a quarter inch gap in between the drywall and the top plate or framing member. When it was put in, framing material was kind of moist. Shrinks over time. When it dries up, you got a long running gap. Air from the attic getting to your walls, interior or exterior. Nowadays, the preferred way of treating that is to foam seal the entire length of your drywall. Now, don't get me wrong, this is a bit of an explanation of this problem, and to do that throughout your house is a bit impractical. You've got insulation up there, you're scooting it all over, it's quite a mess. It may be something that you don't work into. If you have isolated spots of bare insulation, you might be able to. All sorts of problems up there. You can have holes in the stud cavities, looking right into the interior walls. That's what we call balloon framing from the early 1900s. Just fill it in and fold it over. Any plumbing or wiring coming through the attic should be foam sealed. That is required by code now. Unfortunately, things happen after houses are built. This little stepped wall, electrician came in, tore it open, ran a wire down and never bothered to repair it. That light you see going down that one wall, that's attic air, hot attic air coming into a house. Disappointing to see those things. You get to see a lot of strange stuff with the IR camera and in person. A high 14-foot high entry wall. Why is it all, why is the color discolorations? Attic, this is the summer, so the attic air, it is warm. A bat fell off and it's bundled up against it. You got bare drywall, you got, almost 30-degree difference between the insulated and uninsulated areas.
I feel sorry for the photographer.
Is that why you sent me up there that day? You know where that was, don't you? White Sides.
Yeah.
We both participated in the Omaha Green Homes Tour. Anyhow, that's another picture of that house. Attic wall insulation. It's not covered on the back side. Insulation falls out. Gravity takes hold of it. Best thing to do is put something up to retain it. There's different materials that are used. My personal preference is foam board. All sorts of problems lurking up in the attic. Big holes where you have duct chases come up. That too can be filled in. Any chimney should be sealed, both in the basement and in the attic. Metal pipe requires a special caulk, high temp caulk. Masonry chimneys can use just about anything. And ducts don't last forever in the attic. Some fall apart from all the heat up there. Others get disconnected, somebody bumps into it. These are things some handymen can fix themselves, go to the lumber yard or home improvement center and get the materials. But like I say, duct sealing is another topic for another day. Another critical thing is your bathroom vent should vent directly outside. It goes, and it was a practice for many years, and now it's strictly enforced that they do have to be vented through the eaves or through the roof. That one on the left is venting against the sheeting. All that black stuff, well, it's either rot, mold, I don't know what. But your moist bathroom air hits a cold roof sheeting in winter. Condensation, moisture, problems. I've seen mold in these places for sure. Some people just leave it running wild, no duct at all. But that's the proper way to have it, and it should be an insulated duct. If you got moist air inside of a tube, that cold attic air causes condensation, moisture comes running down on you in the bathroom. And ventilation is another issue. Long story on why it's needed, but it is needed in most of our houses where we have uninsulated attics. What's the right word? This is your conventional attic.
Unfinished?
Yeah, whatever. open attic. You need air coming in. Those get blocked. Sometimes they screen access a filter, gets clogged up or painted over. Replace and make sure there's no insulation falling down in it. And if there aren't any, there should be some air chutes to prevent any new insulation coming into the cavity. Your ridge vents, you got basically air flows in and also flow out. This helps get rid of excess moisture during the summer, during winter, and excess heat in the summer. Air flows in and it flows out. I don't know why, but a lot of new houses, they have what looks like a vent in front of the house. They're decorative, they're not cut through. Maybe you don't need them if you have enough air vents, ridge vents. But and a place that's often overlooked is in the knee wall area of a house. These vents go at the peak of an open attic area. Your knee wall closes off the side. Vents are needed there too. And like I was saying before, get the electrical checked out. You should be able to recognize good from bad at a glance. When in doubt, call the electricians. And you can do it yourself. You can add insulation, whether it's bad insulation or blown insulation. Most lumber yards, Lowe's, Menards will sell you bags of blown insulation, cellulose, and they also have blowers for rent, or free with a certain purchase.
Is there one that's better to go blown or versus the batted?
It's a matter of preference. Bats are convenient. You don't have to mess around with equipment. It takes two people to do blown. Somebody has to stand on the ground and open these bags, put them in a hopper, in a long, 100-foot tube, delivers it up in the attic. Somebody's up there with a mask. It's somewhat labor intensive, but you can cover a lot in a short period of time. Any insulation you use, you should have a face mask. But you have with blown insulation, you have the option of fiberglass or cellulose. Fiberglass can be irritating. It's little shards of glass finely spun into an insulating material. You get it on yourself, it'll be itching for a long time. That woman's handling a fiberglass bat, long sleeves, good idea. It's, maybe it's just a small renovation job she's doing. Different strokes for different folks.
I would go with the blown insulation, especially if you're going to hire somebody to do it, because you know really the bats are just for a do-it-yourself little thing. Notice she's not rolling that out right up to the baffles, the vent chutes. She's missing some spots because it's not convenient to fit the batting around all the obstructions.
Mm-hmm.
And the blown insulation will get in all the nooks and crannies.
At least she has the air baffles there.
Yeah.
Of course, one way of doing this is to run it with the joist, but then you run into all these complications. Yeah, it's... And, well, I don't know how far we are from being finished here, but is there a way of seeing what the count is here? I know it's real close here. Now, one thing I'd like to emphasize is, your basement wall is one of the last or final options. You know, people who have adequate attic insulation oftentimes think the next thing to do is get more attic insulation. Well, if your house is recently built, it's got maybe an R38, that's a fair amount of insulation. Well, let's put it R50, R60. Okay, you might be doing something, but it's diminishing returns. You've already got an R38 up there stopping the heat transfer, or slowing down the heat transfer. If you've got an unfinished concrete wall, that's it's what, R1 or 2? Even your soil doesn't have that much. And it can be cool year-round just because the cooling nature of the soil. But it's not good. In our climate zone, we want heat in the winter. You walk into an unfinished basement without insulation in the winter, you can feel the coldness in those times. This photo is a summertime photo inside. You can see the summer heat on the upper wall and the cool of the ground right there. Uninsulated foundations that account for like 25 to 33% of your building's energy loss. Something to think about before we start throwing more money into attic insulation. If you have adequate insulation there. The house my daughter bought, we didn't get a chance to look at the attic before they moved in. Built in 1910, had nothing in the ceiling. That was money well spent there. But just like your attic, you have to do some prep work in deciding what you want to do for your foundation insulation package. You've got water leakage. Don't insulate your basement yet. You're going to have wet insulation, moldy insulation. Take care of any groundwater issues. What's more, just don't go willy-nilly and start throwing things up against the wall. Do a little research, see which method is best. One thing I do know, one prohibition that's out there is if you have a frame wall and insulated wall cavities, do not put poly moisture barrier. There's a organization, buildingscience.com. They have a lot of information on how to considerations on how to design a good functioning basement. Moisture moves both ways in those walls. It's complicated, but it can cause problems, like I say. But you have my way of looking at it is like three basic options: build a frame wall, insulated, drywall. You got added living area. Another option is a foam board called Thermax. There's other brand names for it. It's a highly insulated insulation product, foam board, but it has a covering on it that's fire rated. If you put up pink or blue foam board, that's EXP, extruded polystyrene. It's not rated by the fire code. And there's rhyme and reason for having fire codes, I'm sure. Another item is, because of its fire rating, Thermax is over $30 a sheet, where you can buy an equivalent R-value pink or blue board for maybe $20 a sheet. But just put it up against the wall, and if you do it right, you got a good seal. Good install. The other option is fiberglass blankets. Best if you have an insulator, put it in. It's not as durable as the Thermax, but if you have a basement that's mainly used for storage, it's kind of an inexpensive way of getting protection there. I think that is... another 5 minutes? Okay. Additional tips for easy energy savings and with quick paybacks. Change your air filter at least once a month. I say at least or a minimum of once a month. There are some air filters that are touted as being having a longer life, 2-3 months. They may be. But if you have cats, or for some reason a dusty house, you want to check it at least once a month. And One on the left there, you could barely see through it. It's a high quality air filter, but it wasn't changed for several months. It started off as white. The trim of the filter is white, so long overdue. And if they get clogged, and you keep using it, the blower runs harder, uses more electricity, and the clogged filter acts as a sail. It can start getting sucked into the blower. I've seen them pulled in and shredded. Mm-hmm. So, but it's always good to know what size filter you need. You probably replace like with same. That's usually a good clue. That photo is of a conscientious HVAC installer. He wrote the size, he shows where the airflow is going, and also, you can't read it, but it says change monthly. Conscientious. And having, well, that's that white part is a magnetic plastic strip. It covers the slot. Most of us might have a metal slot, metal cover. Make sure it's on securely. So over here is a filter that extends. It was too large for the opening. It extends about an inch. It's sucking in air from the basement. Well, the furnace doesn't work as well. Sucks in basement odors and whatnot. Best thing to do is to get a flexible cover. In fact, that's a side yard. Books. I have one for sale here. I really promote this for improved air quality. It's called a filter lock, available on the internet. That's an old picture. They now make them in green. So that's for green though, you did. And of course, hopefully we all know to check our dryer hoods, clean out the lint. It's one of the worst I've ever seen there. Actually, I have another one tied to that. The cover comes off easily, just get the lint out of there before it gets so clogged up. When they get clogged, it's going to take you twice as long to dry your clothes. Not to mention it's a fire hazard. Use the correct duct dryers. There's certain metal flex duct that can be used. It's got a rating on it. The white duct, if you use it right now, change it tomorrow or as soon as you can. It's vinyl plastic. It heats up, cracks, and it has holes. That one there is, fortunately, the lint was sealing the holes because that was a gas dryer. Mm. Maybe some of the fumes were coming in there. Again, improves performance and air quality. And, new dryers, you think you're going to be saving energy, but they can have their own set of problems. Of course, you clean the lint off, but why is there an empty spot on that filter? Well, apparently, the dryer sheets have some chemical in it that builds up a deposit on your air filter, so it actually clogs these super fine screens. Good idea to wash it periodically and get it as good as brand new. Like I say, a lot of photos are from my own house. Our dryer, our energy efficient dryer, was running, we set it for an hour and it was running 2 hours. And called the repairman out and he looped me on it. So this advice is free. Don't have to hire a serviceman now. Another spot to service your dryer, there's a catch basin, usually right behind the filter opening. You can pull out lots of lint there too. Hmm. Some of the best things in life are free, at least the one on the right is. How many of you know what temperature your hot water is?
Yeah,
exactly. Well, a little thermometer will give you an idea. This one here is running at 147 degrees.
Oh my gosh.
You could scald yourself with that, folks. The recommended temperature for safety is is between 110 and 120. That's not just me pulling numbers out of the air. That's a combination of talking to the health department and for a minimum, and ADA, Americans with Disability Act, maximum for safety for scalding. There's a temperature control on your furnace, on your water heater. Most electric water heaters have a temperature guide with gas furnaces. Gas water heaters, you just got to guess and keep going back to your faucet. A cheap way to save money is just put insulation blanket on your water heater. $20, you save it in a year's time, the rest of the money in the bank. Most of us keep water heaters for until they leak. 20 years, lifespan or more. Well, you know, the greatest improvement, one of the greatest, latest improvements on water heaters, making them with larger, they're larger diameter because they have more insulation. So they're incorporating that idea.
How about a tankless one?
Well, if you got $1,000 or more to spend, same thing, but nowadays your new replacement tank water heater is going to cost you almost that. So if you want to live long and with an old water heater, that's the best bet.
In the book that you have back there, it has about solar water heaters, and I really haven't seen anything about that. And it says that 1.5 million homes and businesses have already invested in them. I've never seen any ads. Is it in Menards, or
where
do you get
them? There was a rash of that back in the energy scare we had in the 1980s. In fact, a friend of mine was selling solar water heaters at that time. Most of those have been removed by the next owner. That's a lot of improvements have been made, but you have to look at the initial investment and weigh it.
It depends a lot on the climate. Florida, I think they do a lot of that.
Florida, so Arizona.
It's not a Nebraska thing, and that's why they don't see the Menards ad.
Not as much in Nebraska.
This also more bang for your buck here. Changing out CFL, changing out your incandescent bulb with CFLs or LEDs. The prices have come down, and usually you get a payback 1 year or less. That is, if they're in heavily used rooms. Right? Here we have fluorescent bulbs. That's fluorescent is basically what a CFL is, compact fluorescent light. LEDs are more efficient, but the more you use them, the more you save. If you have a closet that you just use, open the door 5 minutes a day, save money. Well, maybe change out the bedroom lights instead before you change out the house light.
It's my understanding that CFLs, the starters go out before the bulb. And if you have a light that you turn off and on several times a day, you might as well get an LED, because they're going to be cheaper in the long run. That's my assumption. That's kind of what I'm learning. And I heard it years ago.
They don't last very long.
In a high school building where the custodian says, don't turn off your light when you leave the room. We'll turn it off after we clean it.
LEDs have gotten a lot better, a lot cheaper in recent years. And I like LEDs.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's about it.
Yay!
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great presentation. Good information.
Yes.
We appreciate it.
How much does one charge for a energy audit?
It depends on the level you want. I can do.
Well, I've got a tri level about 1,800 square feet.
Not so much the square foot, but for me, I have a two tier. I don't know, Mark may have different prices. So.
I want to hear what you say.
Well, just a general price. I'm not going to hold you to it. You don't like it. Okay, yeah, 330
and,
on.
And listen, I know a lot of people have.
Give me a range.
Okay, I'd say anywhere between, say, 275 and 400. That's reasonable. There's some that cost more. And it would depend on how much testing.
When you do an audit, do you sort of break it down and go over it where what changes have to be made and the best way to do it, or do you say this needs to be done? Or do you do it?
Well, just like our presentation here, we give you options.
Okay.
And we'll tell you what seems to be most critical. What
if
it's a safety issue, we're going to say, change your have a plumber change your water heater fluid tomorrow, you know, or call MUD right now and have them confirm this gas leak.
Yeah, that's scary.
So
part of the problem for us as energy auditors is that there's so many different ages of house, so many different configurations, and that's part of the issue with this book. You know, this book kind of hits. Everything
tries to hit all the problems.
Tries to hit all of it, and a lot of it is not applicable to you. So I often end up writing a report. Well, me and I both tend to write a report. That's very labor intensive.
Oh yeah.
I send the infrared photos so that you can see where the leaks were. So that helps guide you. But one thing that I've been lately trying to encourage people is if I can kind of narrow it down to a major area of emphasis over the phone, and I can offer them a limited 2-hour investigation for $150 plus $50 an hour if it goes longer than that. Some people take more time, some houses take more time than others. And if I do a full audit with the report and all the inspections, I usually charge $350.
Would you rather do them during the winter or the summer?
I'd rather do them during the winter.
Really?
Generally
that's
speaking.
Interesting.
Well, this summer has been terrible for doing energy audits because it's been so mild.
It's sort of a not unusual summer.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I guess for a point of reference. I think both of us would prefer to do an audit with an infrared camera. I can do a visual walkthrough and give you a general idea how things are as well. But with the infrared camera, it requires a minimum of 10 degree difference between indoor and outdoor temperatures to show up on the screen.
Yeah. And 20 degrees would give you better results.
Yeah, this summer it's just been crazy. It's so cool.
Part of the problem with infrared is if you don't see anything, it could be a false negative. Maybe you just don't have enough temperature difference.
No, crazy.
So it looks like a great wall, but really, it's not.
Yeah, besides doing it in the winter, I'd rather be in a cold attic than a 140 degree attic. So.
And how can we get a hold of you?
We got our cards.
Back here.
On the back table are the handouts and cards, so you can. Stop by and grab any of the information you want.
Yes. You were talking about if I have vents just on either side, what do you call it, on the outside of the house, you know, the two vents on either side in a small ranch. Do I need any more than that?
Talking about the vents on the end?
Yeah, the end ones. What are the ones that come in and then the two vents on the top?
At least since the 60s, they've had a standing formula for roof ventilation, and the building inspectors check on that. It's like one square foot of venting for every 300 square feet of attic area, something like that.